Good morning, everyone. Welcome to round two of the short talks. Thank you. I'm Lori Bartzak with GEO, and it is my pleasure to introduce you to our second speaker for the morning. This is Deepak Bhargava. He is the executive director for the Center for Community Change. Deepak's been with CCC since 1994, and in his role, works to build social movements by empowering low-income citizens to change their communities for the better. So in this role, he's had a lot of experience working with grantmakers, I think some good, some bad. And today we get to hear about his experiences and some words of wisdom for grantmakers. So thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. There is nowhere I'd rather be giving a somewhat edgy, adventurous talk on this topic than at GEO, whose work I deeply respect, to try and model a new path forward in philanthropy. And I do a lot of public speaking on a lot of topics. I have never actually given a talk on the topic of philanthropy, and I'm a little nervous about it because, as some of you know, the person who hired me at CCC was a gentleman named Pablo Eisenberg, who is a legendary, and in some circles, infamous critic of philanthropy. So it's like the one, I'll talk about anything, it's the one topic I have consistently avoided in my entire career. So welcome to the world premiere of this particular talk. And it actually was harder to prepare than I would have expected. I want to give you a little bit of context. So CCC is a social justice organization grounded in community organizing. And the fundamental part of our DNA, the core of who we are, is a belief that those closest to injustice must play a critical, vital role in leading us towards solutions towards that injustice. Not just because it's the right thing to do, but that it's actually critical to get the right solutions and to have the power and public will to achieve them. So that's kind of who we are. My own particular preoccupation in my career has been how to connect diverse grassroots organizations working with different constituencies to have an impact on big national problems, whether that's reducing poverty or achieving immigration reform, changing policy at the national level or the state level. And philanthropy has been part of all of that work that I have done. And I have seen the good, the bad, and the ugly along the way. And I want to say something here about a philosophical orientation, which may help you make some sense of what I'm going to say. So I subscribe to the view that social change is driven by large-scale social movements that involve thousands and ultimately millions of people in defining and changing structures of power and privilege in society. And it's just worth naming that that is a countercultural view in a society that celebrates celebrities, individual achievement, expertise, insider access, all of that. That is a minority view in our culture. It's also a minority view in philanthropy, that orientation. And the National Committee for Responsive Philanthropy has done tremendous research over the years showing that a tiny fraction of philanthropic resources go towards supporting organizing, movement building, advocacy, and social justice. So in the context of that work that I believe in and do, I have come to some conclusions about the kind of relationship, the implicit norms, rules of behavior that work best and worst between grant seekers and grant givers, all of which takes place in the context, in the backdrop, of believing that we need social movements to move the needle on the big issues of our time. So this is an offering. I hope you will take what is useful to you, and I know you will ignore what is not. I want to start with what I think is kind of the world as it is, the world we live in right now, and the dominant relationship between philanthropy and grant seekers. So I think there are two dominant forms of relationship between grantor and grantee today that are basically antithetical to this social movement orientation. The first, and this is an analogy I struggled with, is basically homeowner to home contractor. It's basically a market relationship. It's fundamentally transactional. The goal is a finished product that looks a certain way, where the contractor is basically an agent to carry out a foundation's agenda, complete with contracts, deliverables, timetables, and so forth. And for those of you who've had work done on your house, you can perhaps relate to the notion that this is a frustrating experience all around. The homeowner thinks, hey, this is my money, and is trying to enforce the terms of a contract, sometimes pushing uphill to do so. The contractor thinks, hey, life is complicated. I've actually got a lot of competing demands, so chill out. Often there's another word inserted in there. And is trying to make room, legitimately, for what in what can feel like a very stifling and narrowly conceived contract. And so in my view, the whole disastrous move to so-called effective philanthropy was a refinement of this basic mental model of what the relationship is, and taking it to somewhat absurd conclusions with predictable results. The second model is a feudal relationship, not a market relationship, but a feudal relationship of lord to serf. And this is a relationship of supplication that at its best is characterized by noblesse oblige. It's a relationship that does not actually exist in many places in our world where modern capitalism has come to dominate the landscape of how we relate to each other. In the system, the liege lord is always right. These are often always longer term relationships than the market transactional relationship. One of the good parts about it is that there are actually obligations that the lord has to the serf that are that must be met. And this is really traditional philanthropy as a phenomenon that is about cultural expressions of power, obedience, status and ritual, a kind of performance. And it's not so much focused on a narrow programmatic end goal, but more on maintaining a field of relationships in a certain prestige hierarchy, in a certain set of power relationships. Both of these relationships, the market model, market mental model, and the feudal model, produce deeply dysfunctional behaviors on the part of grant givers and grant seekers. So for grant givers, there is an underlying elite contempt for low-income and other marginalized people as agents of social change. Their participation is not fundamentally seen to be how it is that major social change happens in this country, in this world. It happens through really smart people from the best universities talking to each other and designing the best solutions. It also results in messiah complexes. So the truth is, any foundation or even all foundations are small players in a very, very large field where there are many other factors dominate what the outcomes are, whether it's government policy, private sector policy, voluntary activity. Foundations are actually a tiny force in producing social change. But in these models, philanthropy can come to see itself as the source of change, as the inspiration for change, as the dominant actor in it. And some of the place-based initiatives that we've seen repeatedly, not all of them are bad, kind of bear this basic mark of thinking that philanthropy is at the center and everything else lives in a constellation around it. The kind of mystification, lack of clarity in much of foundation practice, I think traces back to these mental models because there's a lack of a sense of accountability to a larger movement, a larger cause, a larger calling and purpose, a field of actors. And in the absence of that kind of accountability, you get an inward-lookingness, a solipsism an interiority in the practice that is quite destructive. It results in aversion to conflict in the public square. So what are usually issues of power that are rooted in structures of privilege related to gender, race, and class in our society, there's an effort to reduce them to technical problems that are about what inputs, what interventions might solve the problem. This traces back to this model. And particularly, as in the case of the contractor model, it's a desire to care for the product, the deliverable, the output, but not to care so much about the people or the institutions that are responsible for producing that product and deliverable. So I have plenty of horror stories about these ways of operating, intolerance for disagreement, stunning lack sometimes of curiosity or empathy, a failure to adhere to even basic protocols of decency and respect in a human relationship, overlaid all of this by dynamics of gender, race, and class, of course, because that is how our society functions. But the main point I want to make here is that sometimes we view this as a matter of personal relationship, and it is not an issue of personal relationship or deliberate unkindness. These behaviors flow inherently from these two dominant forms of relationship. They can be better or worse, but as I say to my colleagues who make their way sometimes into the bellies of certain beasts who shall go unnamed, be crystal clear what you're signing up for. Don't act shocked when the craziness begins. That is the implicit contract that you signed up for. Make a judgment at the front end about whether it's worth it to you or not, and don't complain to me later about it. So it's also worth saying these kinds of relationships, these two dominant relationships, produce many, many dysfunctions on the part of grantees that impede our ability to build movement. An unwillingness to be honest about difficulties, challenges, failures, et cetera, that in fact represent the crucial assets, the learning edge for organizations, all of that gets masked and put to the side. An unwillingness to disagree with foundation premises or strategies, even when it is absolutely clear that that is what the foundation desperately needs in order to do its work well. Organizations going into the closet about what they're actually trying to accomplish in the world, because they're trying desperately to translate their own motivations into something that the foundation can receive and fund. A lack of rigor in executing on deliverables that are allegedly mutually agreed to, because these deliverables were never actually deeply owned in the first place by the organization. They're seen as problems to be managed, messaged, in order to get the money and do the work. So that's the world as it is. I want to talk about my view that another world is possible, and in fact, she is already here. There is an emergent way of doing business that exists right now that I've seen. I think it is still a vast minority tendency in philanthropy, but I want to lift it up, celebrate it, and point to some of the examples as ways that might inform how we proceed in the future. One case, the community of immigrant rights funders in the United States, after the disastrous welfare bill in 96, after 9/11, came together to support a field and helped to nurture and build a movement of immigrants in the country. So moving from a handful of organizations in a few states to groups in almost every state in the union that are networked with each other, that are generating powerful and inspiring leaders, that are winning on policies at a whole variety of levels, that are changing the culture and the dominant narrative, and that arguably have more mobilization capacity than almost any other sector. None of that would have been possible without the dynamism and leadership of immigrants themselves. Let's be clear about the causation. But it was aided and supported in a crucial way at crucial times by philanthropy. The work of the funders who supported the struggle for LGBT rights in this country in a very different way, and I'm less close to this case, similarly helped to make a bet on a big vision that was long-term in nature, that wasn't going to be achieved in a 1 or 2 year grant cycle, and built a community with the leading practitioners and advocates in that field to design, retool a strategy, and stick with it. And the job is still far from done, but enormous progress has been achieved. I've seen it in large foundations, the JPB Foundation, which has made a major commitment to reducing and eradicating poverty in the United States at a time when the word poverty has been demonized, a time when poor people have been demonized. The Open Society Foundation, which took on the issue of criminal justice reform at a time when it was far from popular or current in the national discourse. I've seen it in mid-sized grant givers, Unitarian Universalist Beach Program at Shelter Rock, the Haas Jr. Fund, which have been long-standing supporters of movements, of organizations, of leaders, and have seen themselves as part of an ecosystem of change. And if we reflect back on the history of social change in this country, philanthropy has a very important role to play. If you think about the role of the Ford Foundation or the Field Foundation or Taconic in supporting some of the key leaders and organizations in the civil rights movement in this country. So my conclusion from that brief review of some examples is that the problems I spoke of do not inhere, they're not inherent in philanthropy itself. We can freely admit there are plenty of contradictions about how the system operates, but that there are examples in our own lived experience and in historical experience where philanthropy has made huge contributions to changing this country and to liberating millions of people with great success. So I've tried hard to figure out the right metaphor. So if it's not a homeowner-contractor relationship, if it is not a lord-serf relationship, if it's not a market model, if it's not a feudal model, what is this other model, this other way of doing business? How would we describe it? What would we think about it? And I'm still struggling to find the word, so maybe you can help. I thought about comradeship, and I thought maybe that was a little too communist for this crowd. I thought about fraternité, and I thought maybe that's a little too French for this crowd. I thought about the idea in Buddhist practice of a sangha, a community of spiritual truth tellers, and that may be a little too Buddhist for this crowd. So I'm going to use these words provisionally, but I want to argue that the model we should strive for between grantor and grantee is a form of public friendship. And I want to rush to tell you what I think you're already thinking, which is I do not mean by this personal friendship or relationship. But the reason I use the word is that in this kind of relationship, there's a greater quality of intimacy than there is of bureaucracy. And so there are some dilemmas in using that word, but that's the reason that I chose it. And let me lay out some principles for what that relationship can look like. First, grantee and grantor are united by a shared vision of a big change in the world. Marriage equality, immigration reform, ending poverty, changing the broken criminal justice system. Some deep change that is motivating and that situates both actors in a field of mutual accountability. Secondly, that shared field of accountability that both the grantor and the grantee live in constrains the behavior of both parties and it enables it. It constrains it in that it creates some norms, like you can't go off and do that, that is crazy. But it also enables because it creates the possibility for new ideas to emerge from any part of that field of practice. It's a generative space. Third, grantor and grantee care about each other's development as an intrinsic good. We don't care just about the product or the work, but we care about the institutions and the people creating it. We think about empathically and with moral imagination the imperatives, the constraints, the challenges, the dilemmas that the other face and see ourselves bound in some common enterprise. We think of ourselves as custodians of institutions, not as owners of them, but who are holding the torch for a period trying to leave it in a better place for the next set of actors who will inherit it to take it on. We have respect for the art side of social change, not just the science side. And I do believe in the science side, counting, measurement, evaluation, and so on. But social movements are inherently human enterprises, and humans are inherently not entirely subject to measurement. There is a work of judgment that is required, that requires maturity and sophistication and a humanistic kind of temperament. Maybe most importantly, the time horizon is long. So big changes in our society on any of the topics that we've talked about are decades-long endeavors. If you looked at the African-American freedom struggle in the 1920s, or you looked at the struggle for marriage equality 15 years ago, you would not have looked at that optimistically. They are long endeavors that go beyond 1 or 2 year grant cycles, and so this takes a kind of resolved patience, a commitment to long-term relationship that, again, is countercultural in a world that is about the short-term transaction. There is a foundation of trust in the relationship, in the sincerity, in the competence, in the values of the other that creates a foundation for creating things together. That trust is foundation. It's not marketing. It's not kind of a ritual supplication. It's not telling people how smart they are. It's actually the foundation for this last point, which is creative conflict. That in this relationship, there is conflict. There is tension. There are disagreements. And people who may totally share a vision of the promised land will disagree a lot on the means and tactics to get there. That's all to the good. That is a positive thing. But that can be a source of creativity and generativity in this context of a public friendship in the way that it cannot in the other models. So last thing I'll say in conclusion is, so there is an alternative social contract that is possible between philanthropy and grantees in the context of social movement practice. I believe that this requires great humility because neither philanthropies nor organizations can create social movements. They can aid them, help them, support them, connect them, accelerate them, perhaps. And they can play a pivotal role in whether they ultimately succeed in their goals or not. If that's true, then one of our most important tasks is to try to unearth this tradition that does exist in our history, that exists today, this positive vision, and in our troubled and dangerous times to make it come alive and persuade a new generation of philanthropists that this new world is possible, because this world is in need of a lot of change. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepak. Thank you for your honesty and for pushing us to think differently about our relationship with grantees. So we have one more round of short talks. They'll be starting at 10:35. And if you'd like to talk with Deepak more, you can do so at 11:15. Thank you.
Thanks. That's what you think.